And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the highway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. And through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not the right to say the things he feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way.
Now, at least I know many Americans will know that song, and it's My Way by Frank Sinatra. What was his nickname? Some people can help me online in the thread. You can help me. Was his name kind of a nickname, Chairman of the Board? That just came to me now. So if those of you watching live, or if you're watching on tape delay, you can tell me, is that correct or not? Well, this is one of his signature songs, and actually I didn't know this, I didn't know who wrote it, but actually Paul Anka actually wrote the song, and it came out in 1968. I was all of 5 years old at that time. Maybe if it was done really late, maybe almost 6 years old. And once I got a little bit older and kind of heard the song and understood it, I really liked the song. I mean, I still like this song to this day. I will sometimes continue humming it or singing it and singing the words. It is such an American classic that you will hear it sometimes in movies, sometimes in television shows. You will even hear it in commercials. It's one of those things that's as American as apple pie. And if you listen or read the lyrics, it really espouses an American ethos. So I'm going to read just a few of the lines that are from the song. It might even be a few of the lines that I did not show because I gave you an abridged version of the song. So it says, I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. And through it all, whenever there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. Wow, that is so American. I don't know if that's Liberian or how your country is, but you know how you hear the pull yourself up by your own bootstraps, the independent spirit, the pioneering spirit. You just go do everything. You're able to do it yourself. But there's a challenge here. I hope you do hear it. Or when you read it, you see it. Whose way should we be following? As you know, we are following after Jesus right now, and we're in the Sermon on the Mount, and we're in the Lord's Prayer. At verse 10, we're going to Matthew 6:10, we're going to get there. So when we're thinking about what Jesus is telling us at this point on the Sermon on the Mount, and specifically in the Lord's Prayer, what is he talking about? You're going to hopefully, I don't want to give it away yet, but he's kind of communicating about a certain way to follow, no term he may, whose will. He's going to talk about the will. Even though the world glorifies doing things my way, or you doing things the way you want to do it. Is that really the right way? What is the right way to do things? Whose way should we be following? That's the topic for today as we investigate more in the Lord's Prayer. So let's pray. Lord, as I'm just going to use that model prayer, that structure, and I'll just say, Lord, your will be done, not my will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's go. I basically already said it, but let's go to Matthew 6, verse 10. And it says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's the English Standard Version translation. Most of the more modern translations have that. If you're reading King James, obviously, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So if you're used to that, that is why. So to make the language more of how we talk today, because we do not use thys anymore, thy is means your at this time. So we left off last week discussing in verse chapter 6, again, Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, the last piece, C, 9C, is hallowed be thy name when discussing God. And we were just, that sermon last week was to talk about just how much, how far above, how majestic, holy, beautiful, how much far other beyond God is from who we are and how we are. And so far beyond, we can't even, there's no human words in any language that can express the gulf between, I can't even get my hands, I get it in a frame. That's not way, it's so much more that you can't even express it. So we have to understand that as we continue in this prayer. So if I go back, I says, our Father who is in heaven. So we talked about how God's our Father who cares about us, who is in heaven. We talked about what heaven is, giving you more information than lots of times pastors and teachers talk about heaven, letting you understand that there's so much more that God actually does talk about of how heaven is. And these are things when we're doing the framework, when we're praying, we should be thinking about, and hallowed be thy name. So we take all of that together, and now we make a petition. And so this petition is your kingdom come. Your kingdom come. So we're going to start there with what does that mean? Your kingdom come. What are we asking? And so I'm going to give just some information from some commentaries that discuss this. So I'm going to first talk about the Kaddish. Now, it's spelled different ways. So sometimes I see it as Kaddish, and sometimes I see it as Quaddish. Now, the Kaddish is a hymn praising God that was used during Jewish worship services. Okay, when we're talking about the Old Testament. Okay, so in the Old Testament, this is, and when you would go to the temple, or when Jewish gatherings came together to worship God, the Kaddish is one of the things you would hear hymns with that. So here's a line from the Kaddish says, "May he," this is God, "rule his kingdom in your lifetime, and in your days, and in the lifetime of the whole house of Israel, speedily and soon." And there are other lines in the Kaddish which are similar to this. So this kingdom coming for the Messiah, again, you have to remember Israel is waiting for that Messiah to come back, and we now know that that is Jesus. For them, remember, you have to remember they are under oppression with the Romans, and so they wanted this Messiah to set things right for God's kingdom to come. So they desire it. Now they've had God's kingdom before. Okay, you go back, but remember they didn't want God to be their king. They rebelled. They constantly did things which were against God, and eventually they asked for their own king, which we are going to get there today specifically. All right. So with one side of their mouths, and you can put ourselves in that situation too, is like we're saying, yes, we want your kingdom, Lord. We want it to come. And we even see this obviously in the earliest part of Christianity, that one of the early, actually the oldest Christian prayer that we have a firm record of states this, three words, "Come, O Lord!" Exclamation point. So come, O Lord. Our desire is that for you to be empowered, that all parts of your kingdom be manifest here, right now, here on the earth. And the word you hear sometimes, Maranatha, or actually Maranatha, sorry, my fault, Maranatha. I'll spell that for you. And some of you probably have seen that before, but that's what Maranatha means, is come, O Lord. So Maranatha. I'll say that again. Maranatha. Maranatha. So when talking about the kingdom coming, we are not talking about the kingdom coming into existence. We know God has done that with Jesus Christ by breaking the kingdom, him going to the cross. The kingdom is now. It is in existence. But the prayer we're doing here, and again, this is a structure, was that thy kingdom come. It is that we want God's kingdom to manifest itself more here on this earth. We see a lot of broken things, obviously, on this earth. We want God's kingdom to be manifest much more completely. And we want it to continue and to continue until it is like, and we're going to see this later, like it is in heaven. We want the full and complete manifestation and consummation of God's kingdom. So specifically, we should pray for the day when our Savior God, the Lord Jesus Christ, will set up his kingdom on earth and reign in righteousness as God is reigning in heaven. That is our prayer. That is what we desire. So when we say that, your kingdom come, that is our desire. Now, we don't always have to say exactly again those words, but he's giving us a framework of how to pray, because we see so much in the world where it doesn't look like that. So we should be, he's calling us to pray in that way. So your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So let's talk about your will be done. So again, let's go again in talking about God's will. We're going to go to a commentary, and I'm going to intersperse my thoughts and what I'm trying to get across to you as well. So anyway, so in this appeal, it's to be linked to what we talked about previously, your kingdom coming, okay? So your kingdom comes. So in this appeal, wherever the kingdom of heaven exerts its presence, God's will is experienced. That makes sense, does it? If God's kingdom is manifesting itself here on earth, then God's will be seen, will be shown, and will be experienced by all. God reigns in heaven absolutely, which means that all of heaven experiences his perfect will. Jesus here shows us that we are to pray that earth will experience that same rule of God. The term for will is thelema, which can indicate God's purpose, and that's in Ephesians 1:11, God's purpose. It can also mean God's desire, which you see in Luke chapter 13, verse 34. But for here, the term expresses God's will of command. And we're going to go to Psalm 40, chapter 40, verse 8, to talk about what that is, what we're talking about here. So Psalm 40, verse 8, I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. Again, I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. Now, this delight and desire to do God's will, not your own, we see manifested in Jesus right from the beginning of Jesus's earthly ministry. Right from the beginning. So one of the things, and we're going to go to John chapter 4, verse 34. Again, John chapter 4, verse 34. So we're really right near the beginning of Jesus's earthly ministry. And Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. I hope you hear that. I'm going to say that again. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. And we need to understand in accomplishing his work, this is not always easy. In accomplishing the work of the Father that we are given, we got to remember, we are on mission. We got to, so many times, we got to think of ourselves so much more as a soldier for the Lord. And that visual is given, as you know, in the New Testament, Paul talks about that. But Jesus epitomizes this so much and patterns this for us to make us understand in following after the Father's will, there are going to be times when you're not going to want to do it, where it is not fun. So there is nothing more painful in the history of human existence for what Jesus had to go through in going to the cross and being separated from the Father. So it's not just the physical. It's the emotional and the spiritual supernatural, which we can't even understand because it's the separation that he experienced, that he knew he had to experience to take on all of our sins. And Jesus communicates that to us, shows us how much so he did not, in a sense, want to go to the cross, in a way. So let's go to Matthew chapter 26, verse 39. Matthew chapter 26, verse 39. And again, I think it's from 36 to 46. Those verses of scripture have transformed my life. But we're just going to read 39. And going a little farther, he, Jesus, fell on his face and prayed, saying, My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. This is critical for us to understand. It is okay when going through whatever we're going through, and our desire is to do that not unto and for ourselves, but to glorify God. Okay, remember, tagline of A Church in the World, coaching people for the glory of God. It's always for His glory. There are sometimes you're going to go through stuff, and we see from Jesus, even Jesus asked the Father, is there another way? I really don't want to do this. Father, if there's any other way, I know we went over this before time began, before the earth was formed. But that just shows you, again, the humanness of Jesus, not humanness in a bad sense, but humanness asking the Father for help. But in the final analysis, always submitting to what the Father knows is best. And again, Jesus, God, He knows this, but I believe this is written here for us to help us when we're going through those challenges, that pain, that suffering. Because again, if you read 26 through 46, and I encourage you to do that, Jesus asked three times about this. He knew it was coming, but He still asked three times. It is about God's interests first. It's His interest first, period. So in this petition, when we go, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, we acknowledge that God knows what is best and that we surrender our will to His. We surrender whatever knowledge we think we know and submit it to Him. It also expresses a longing for His will, His way to be done throughout the earth. Quite simply, all prayer, first of all, willingly submits to God's purposes, plans, and glory. I'll say that again. All prayer, first of all, willingly submits to God's purposes, plans, and glory. So when we read this, we give mental assent many times. Those of us who say we are following Jesus. But here's the challenge. Jesus really wanted what the Father wanted and wants. We say we do. But do we really? Do we really mean it? Well, we mean it if it's easy. We mean it if it's something good that we are going to receive, something pleasant to our flesh. But how about something difficult? Something challenging? Something unpleasant? Or something we don't want to do? Or something we feel that's unfair? Or do we kind of modify? Well, we kind of know either whether it's from Scripture or we kind of in prayer in our hearts, we know God is calling us and unctioning, kind of moving us in a direction to do something. And we say, I'm good with this, and this one. I'm a little at this one, then I'm good with this, but this one's slow. I can tweak that a little. So I'm really doing what God wants me to do. I'm just going to tweak this one a little. That's okay. Who would notice? The outcome is still going to be what God wants, right? God has given us free will. So we have this flexibility. God wants us to use our creativity, right? So that's it's okay, right? There are numerous examples I could use, but I'm going to use it since we had talked about kings earlier and about how Israel basically said, "Well, I know you're king, Lord, but we want to have our own king. So let's go to that guy." Because you know what? He did that. He did. We're in an American football season. I know there's something that a quarterback does. So those of you who do not watch American football, I will explain. Does what's called an audible. An audible means from the sidelines, the head coach or the offensive coordinator or whoever is giving the plays gives a play that the team is supposed to run. But the quarterback, either when they're gathered together in what's called the huddle, or they go to and they're getting ready to do the play, he sees something which he doesn't like. And he audibles, he changes it. That's what an audible means. So he changes it. He may change it a little, he may change it a lot. So Saul, we're going to see, chose to do an audible. Now, I do need to give a little qualifier here. If you have young children at this time, whether we're live, you're watching us live, or you're watching us via video, you may want to move them to a different room because this is one of those parts in the Bible which is quite graphic. And it's actually it's very tough for some Christians to actually even go through because they feel, I'll just read it. But I did want to give that little quick disclaimer before we continue. All right, I have to do something. Sorry. I have a whole bunch of things coming up on my screen, so I'm trying to get rid of those. Oh, there they go. Okay, sorry about that. All right, so we're going to 1 Samuel 15, pretty much reading the entire chapter, 1 through 33. Okay. 1 Samuel chapter 15, pretty much the whole chapter. Pretty much the whole chapter. All right, let's get started. And Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people Israel. Now therefore listen to the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I have noted what Amalek did to Israel in opposing them on the way when they came up out of Egypt. Now go and strike Amalek and devote to destruction all that they have." Okay, these are the Amalekites. "Do not spare them, but kill," I want you to hear this, this is rough, "both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep and camel and donkey." I'm going to pause there. God is telling Samuel to tell Saul to completely annihilate the Amalekites. This is very difficult for a lot of Christians. Well, God is a God of love, so that's not a God, that so the God of the Old Testament, it's not the New Testament. Now, I don't have time to go into all things, but when you don't do what God is telling you to do, and all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, So all of us deserve death immediately. And since he created all things, it is up to him how he wants to do things. And since all of the Amalekites and all the Israelites, all of the Anyites have sinned against God, God could choose to wipe us all out. It's amazing he doesn't. And in the New Testament, if you go to Acts chapter 5, I think, read the story of Ananias and Sapphira. Yeah, that's New Testament. And take a look at what God does to them. And with how they handled a situation where they chose to do an audible. But we haven't gotten to the audible yet, so let's continue. Verse 4. So Saul summoned the people and numbered them in Telaim. 200,000 men on foot and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came to the city of Amalek and lay in wait in the valley. Then Saul said to the Kenites, "Go, depart, go down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them. For you showed kindness to all the people of Israel when they came up out of Egypt." So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. So the Kenites, they heard what it was put, and they left. Verse 7, and Saul defeated the Amalekites from Havilah as far as Shur, which is east of Egypt. And he took Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive, and devoted to destruction all the people with the edge of the sword. Verse 9, but Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep and of the oxen, and of the fattened calves, and the lambs, and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them. All that was despised and worthless, they devoted to destruction. That makes sense. Yeah, you know that makes sense. It's like, okay, God told us to get rid of everything, but he couldn't have meant everything, not the good things. Because we could use the good things. We could give the good things away. For charity, for the poor. This would be helpful for the people who are starving. That's not, that, you know, I understand, but that he meant everything but the good stuff. Let's continue, verse 10. The word of the Lord came to Samuel. I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments. Now, I need to pause quickly here. I do not have time to go into this. This is a whole nother subject, but I'm going to need you to read after it's over, okay? And we'll talk about it later. This regret makes you think, though, okay, God, what? He regrets stuff? That means he kind of didn't know that Saul was going to do this sort of stuff? Well, you need to read verse 11 and verse 29. Now, I'm going to get to verse 29. But if you read both of them together, and when I get there, you'll say, like, well, wait a minute. Okay, I don't think regret can mean what I think regret means because of what verse 29 says. We're going to get there. But I do need to address that because you will hear that from other people saying that, hey, God doesn't know all that he's doing, even though other places in the Bible talks about God does know all things and knows the end from the beginning. So you're like, it's a paradox. People will say it's a contradiction. No, it's a paradox. But again, I don't have time. I'm focusing on this. Okay, let's keep going. And Samuel was angry, and he cried to the Lord all night. And Samuel rose early to meet Saul in the morning, and it was told Samuel, Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set up a monument for himself and turned and passed on and went down to Gilgal. Verse 13, and Samuel came to Saul and said to Saul, blessed be you to the Lord, I have performed the commandment of the Lord. So Saul's saying to him, hey, I did exactly what God told me to do. Clap for me. And Samuel said, "What then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears and the lowing of the oxen that I hear?" I like answer question. It's a good thing always start off with a question. The person who's asking the questions is in control of the conversation. 15, verse 15, Saul said, "They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice," see, a sacrifice, "to the Lord your God, and the rest we have devoted to destruction." See, we're supposed to sacrifice to God. So that's why we did this. We know that's what God meant when he told us, when you told me that. Then Samuel said to Saul, "Stop. I will tell you what the Lord said to me this night." And he said to him, "Speak." This is what Saul said to him. And Samuel said, "Though you are little in your own eyes, are you not the head of the tribes of Israel?" Again, he was from Benjamin, and it was the smallest tribe in Israel. And I think in Benjamin, he was one from smallest like families in that. "The Lord anointed you king over Israel." 18, "And the Lord sent you on a mission and said, go devote to destruction the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they are consumed. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you pounce on the spoil and do what was evil in the sight of the Lord?" And this is what Saul says, and this is what I know I say, and many of us say many times, when we do most of what God has communicated us to do, whether from the Bible or from the Holy Spirit communicating to us. And Saul said to Samuel, "I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. I have gone on the mission on which the Lord sent me." Yes, he did go on a mission. "I have brought Agag, the king of Amalek." Yeah, he did, he was supposed to do that. He did do that too. "And I have devoted the Amalekites to destruction." Yes, he has devoted all the other Amalekites, the people, to destruction. So he gives all the stuff he did do. And many times ourselves in following not God's will, but God's will with a little flavor of ourselves, which actually ends up being our will. There's a number of things we can take off saying that we actually did, and we did for God. That we did a good job. We did so well, we should have gotten an A, like a 91 out of 100. Hey, we didn't do 100, but we got a 91. That's A. That's great work. But now, I know I do this sometimes. Ugh, I hope I don't do it as much. 21. Look. The blame game starts. So Saul's like, "Oh, you know what? But the people took of the spoil. Sheep and oxen, the best of things devoted to destruction to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. And the people did it. It wasn't me. I had nothing to do with it." 22. And Samuel said, "Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to listen than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as sin of divination, and presumption, presuming that you know what God means, and changing, and presumption as is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king." We're going to stop there due to time. But we're going to skip down from there. So we just finished verse 23, but we're going to skip down to verse 32 because I do want you to see what happens here. Verse 32. "Then Samuel said, bring here to me Agag, the king of the Amalekites. And Agag came to him cheerfully Agag said, "Surely the bitterness of death is past." Verse 33. And Samuel said, "As your sword has made women childless, so shall your mother be childless among women." And Samuel, the prophet, hacked Agag to pieces before the Lord in Gilgal. I told you this was rough. God is very serious about his will and about doing all of his will. It is his way. It is not my way. It is not your way. It is not mostly his way with some of my way. That is why it's interesting with that song, My Way, which I really do like. I really try not to sing it anymore. Because, again, the lyrics give a state of mind which is contrary to what I want to do and to be. I want to do God's will. I want to desire God's way. 100% pure, unadulterated, unfiltered, with no preservatives or additives. His will alone. What you say to yourself, what you read, what you watch, it's really important. Your subconscious mind cannot take a joke. It is so important. So, a lot of people say, it's just a song. No, words matter. Words matter. We saw that with what God said to Samuel and for Samuel said to Saul. Those words mattered, exactly how those words were. And when Saul modified them slightly, that was not any longer the will of God, the way of God. For God's kingdom presence to manifest in my life, in our lives, it's going to require suffering and sacrifice. Jesus showed us this. Joseph showed us this, being thrown in the well, imprisoned. Even if I don't understand at the time, even if I don't like it. My prayer for myself and all of us is for us to be conformed to God's will. That is obviously the best, as Jesus has communicated to us when we say, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So I'm going to leave you with a little change on the last part of that Paul Anka song. I will do the best I can. Please do not laugh too hard, but I need to do this for me, because sometimes I know that song's going to pop in my head, but I'm going to, words matter, and I want to do all of God's will. I want to do all of God's way.
For what is a man? What has he got? If not the Lord, then he is not. To say the things he truly feels, and to bow down as one who kneels. The record shows you took the blows. I'll do it your way.
Yes, I'll do it your way. Love you guys. See you next week at a church in the world.